And we are beyond thrilled to welcome you to our campus and to welcome Mr. Dean and his family, his wife Nancy, his son Travis, his daughter Whitney, and his three lovely grandsons with us tonight. So we will start with dinner in a few minutes and enjoy that time together, and then have the formal program after we've enjoyed dinner together. At this time, though, I'd like to introduce you to Mark Brown, who will come and offer a blessing.
Let us pray. Almighty God, creator, redeemer, sustainer, and giver of story, we're grateful for this day and for this evening on which we celebrate story and its importance to our existence. It is central to our belief in you, our history, our families, and our quality of life. Thank you for those who have made their livings by telling stories. And a special thanks for the life and talents of our honoree, Steve Dean. Thank you for the impulse which set into motion a quarter century of preservation and celebration of a geographical region and its people. Thank you for those with whom Steve worked and for those decision makers who saw the value of that vision. Lord, we ask blessings on those who can continue to use this important repository long after we all are gone. And we ask blessings for a new generation of storytellers, ones who know more than alternative facts and cat videos. Lord, bless this food to our nourishment and bless our lives to making a difference, both for temporal and eternal good. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Well, again, welcome to Carson-Newman University and to the Appalachian Cultural Center, to the 2017 Outstanding Educational Service to Appalachia Award. We are thrilled to welcome Steve Dean, to Carson-Newman as we honor his work and his vision and his life as an educator. And so for the next few minutes, we would like to celebrate his classroom and all that he has taught the hundreds of thousands of students that he may never have actually seen their aha moments, but that he has helped create. To bring us together and to call us together, we are honored to welcome home Jeff Daniel Marion, Danny Marion, who founded the Appalachian Cultural Center, who served as creative writing professor here for his career, who remains one, if not the most important poetic voices in Appalachia. He is here tonight to read a poem in Mr. Dean's honor. So please join me in welcoming Jeff Daniel, Danny Marion, back home to Carson-Newman. Thank you, Danny.
I'm reminded of a story that Wilma Dykeman told one time. There was a recent inductee to the world of heaven. St. Peter was taking this person on a tour, showing all the heavenly wonders. So when the tour was finished, the new person said, "Well, this is truly fabulous and what I sort of always thought heaven would be, but we passed a giant field that had all these people chained to trees. What is that? I mean, this is supposed to be heaven." So St. Peter looked and said, "Well, I'll tell you. Those people are all from southern Appalachia, and if we don't keep them chained, they'll go home the first chance they get." Well, coming back home is part of my family story. We were part of that great migration in the 1940s that went to the industrial centers during the war. I was 3 years old and we left East Tennessee, my father, to find work in Detroit. And some of my earliest memories are of those cold winters and of starting to kindergarten there. And this poem that I want to read comes out of a series of poems called Detroit Days. We lived in the projects. We were lucky to get in the projects because we lived in a basement apartment that the only heat was from the oven to the kitchen stove. And the city condemned it, and so we went to the projects. So this is a poem out of the Detroit projects, and it's called The Call, 1945. And I know most of you here remember the days when telephones actually rang, when there were such things as pay telephones, telephone booths. We did not have a telephone in Detroit, and this is partly about that. The Call, 1945. War behind us. My father sleeps late on a Saturday, dreams of a morning in May, back in the mountains, chores done. Wind sighs in the long leafy arms of willow. Far away clink of trace chains, his father hitching horses, my father waking to call of three knocks from our apartment door, rouses to hop across cold floor here. You J.D. Marion? Stranger's stare demands, offers, you got a long distance call down at the phone. My mother watches him bound down the steps and cross the street to the only telephone in our section of the projects. Sure trouble back home. Maybe message of death brought by this stranger. Why else this call? My mother hugs her bathrobe closer, shivers to see him cradle the cold receiver. Listen to voice crackle across 600 miles. Back upstairs, my father grins. Wake that boy and roust him out. Sweet mountains, here we come. They call to offer my old job back. His grin fades, a new cloud of mystery, before saying, I forgot to thank him. He shakes his head, tongue clucking. There'll be plenty of time when we get home, she says. No, no, not him. That stranger we'll never see again, who took the call and gave us our ticket to Tennessee.
What a beautiful convocation. What a beautiful way to capture the call, the beauty of this sacred place that we call Appalachia. For it is the call and the beauty of this sacred place that tonight's recipient of the Outstanding Educational Service to Appalachia Award, Stephen Dean, forgot Miss Myrtle and Mr. Wilbur would say Stephen Dean, has honored throughout his own career and with his own creative vision, which frankly makes it more difficult to confess to all of you sitting here what I have to confess, especially to my fellow members of the Appalachian Cultural Center Committee. I'm nervous, I want to make sure I don't leave anyone out. If you were here, if you would stand, please. Dr. Vicki Barker, Dr. Mary Baldridge, Dr. Megan Hersher, Professor Ann Jones, Dr. Susan Underwood, and Professor Dave Underwood. Thank you all so much for your help and your leadership. So I am a bit nervous to confess what I have to confess. Mr. Dean, if you will forgive me, in lieu of a formal traditional introduction that highlights your many, many accomplishments, 25 years of Heartland, almost 2,000 episodes, Emmys, Iris Awards, Board of Directors, Museum of Appalachia, the East Tennessee Civil War Alliance, I couldn't resist. But instead, I stand before you for a brief moment or two, not as Jennifer Hall, director of the Appalachian Cultural Center, but as one of your hundreds of thousands of students. For that minute or two, I am once again Jenny Wallace. You can call me Jenny tomorrow at school. One-time reluctant daughter of Appalachia. As an educator, which is certainly the part of your giftedness that we are honoring tonight, you may not have had as many opportunities as those of us in the traditional classroom to witness the aha moments that you have created. But trust me, there are many, hundreds of thousands, millions, and I can testify to that fact. When I was 9, my father was unexpectedly and suddenly medically retired from what my family believed would be a lifelong naval career. Mom and Daddy's answer to this terrifying news was to go home, home to Tennessee, home to the mountains. Wise, all-knowing child that I was fine to go visit Grandma and Grandpa, my cousins, my aunts and uncles in Tennessee. But I was absolutely not fine, not okay with going home to a place that pop culture and my friends at naval bases in Spain and Monterey and San Diego and Pensacola had already taught me to see as less than. I did not want to go home to a place where people were backward, where they talked too slowly, where they dropped their G's, and they didn't wear shoes. I was a Navy kid, I was cultured, and I was not a hillbilly. And I was not going to make this move easy. End of uncomfortable confession. Thankfully, it did not take me long to encounter the educators and teachers in my life who would show me just how wrong I was. And one of those teachers, Mr. Dean, was you and your creative team from Channel 10, from the Heartland series, so I thank all of you as well. From you and from your creative team, from your classroom, I learned that being straight from the heart of East Tennessee is a blessing and not a curse. For Appalachia is a place of great beauty, art, culture, science, a community, not a place about which to be ashamed. From Teacher Dean and your creative vision and your Heartland creative team, I learned to revere the beauty of our mountains, Cades Cove, Elkmont, Greenbrier, the French Broad, to see the sacred in her wildflowers, her wildlife, her trees, her geology, to appreciate the mountain-strong people, their wisdom, their resiliency, to celebrate the craftsmen and artistry of their crafts, whether making soap or carding wool or blowing glass or throwing pottery. To celebrate the scientists, engineers, poets, storyteller, philosophers whose wisdom contributes so much to our community and to our global community. To see the diversity of our people, from our Scots-Irish roots to the native Cherokee to our communities of color. To hear Guy Carawan's hammered dulcimer with joy, to wish my garden would have the glory of that of the Walker sisters, to see my own sons try to match the fly rod mastery of Walter Babb, to laugh at Jack Tales and the storytellers, often through that unforgettable baritone of Mr. Landry, who held us spellbound, to see part to meditate and to be held spellbound by the videography of Doug Mills, to see part of my family, my community, and myself in the stories of Appalachian Heartland. So now, 30-something years later, Mr. Dean, I, among your countless many students, can stand before you not as a reluctant or hesitant or embarrassed Appalachian, but as a proud Appalachian woman and as a graduate of the Heartland series. One who proudly claims to be straight from the heart of East Tennessee and who chooses to honor our people and our culture, who chooses to raise my own 4 children in a place of which they can and should and must and will be proud. So teacher, educator, Mr. Steve Dean, son of Wilbur and Myrtle, husband of Nancy, father to Travis and Adam and Whitney, granddad to Cooper, Jackson, and Henry, thank you. Thank you for being part of my life journey and the journey of so many students whose lives have been validated, celebrated, enriched, and respected because you taught us to validate, celebrate, and respect this special place we call home. Please help me in thanking Steve and his lovely wife, Nancy, as they make their way to the podium. Mr. and Ms. Dean, we have a few gifts that we would like to present to you tonight. I would like to also thank Ms. Taylor Mauser, the wonderful student assistant, and Emily Phillips in the Appalachian Cultural Center, who helped design and organize this evening. So they're part of this celebration as well. First, the gift of poetry from Danny tonight. Thank you so much. For he represents the voices of our people whose work you have helped preserve and honor. We'd also like to present you with a plaque that you can hang on your wall proudly, we hope, and remember tonight's evening fondly. A small honorarium that we hope you will use to treat your family to a special evening somewhere in the mountains or perhaps with your new farm.
There you go.
And then also something about which I'm very excited. One of Carson Newman's own alum, Robert Elwine, has his pottery in the Glades community of Gatlinburg. And they did survive, and it's been a bit hard since November. But there are three generations of potters who are throwing at the Elwine pottery at this point. So Mr. Elwine, along with Katie Barnes, one of his head designers, have designed tonight's gift for Mr. Dean. Okay. I've been told that I need Mr. Elwine has designed this to both capture the beauty of nature, but Katie has also carved on the front the Heartland Cabin, and you can come after and see the inscription. She's done a beautiful inscription to Mr. Dean on this work, and I can think of no better work of art to symbolize how strong that community has continued after the fire than a lump of clay that never knew it could look this good. And that's the way the mountain people face adversity, right? So Mr. Elwine sends his very best. He has taken his lovely bride, Connie, on a retreat, along with their daughter, Lynn, and Carmen, and Mark, all of whom work at the pottery. They send your best and send their very best thanks for all of your work representing the artisans of Tennessee as well, Appalachia as well.
Thank you so much. Will be a successful speech if I do not cry. The older I get, the more likely that is to happen. So, in November of, on November 19th, I believe it was, or 29th, 1863, President Abraham Lincoln delivered one of this country's most memorable speeches, the Gettysburg Address. It is 272 words. It was delivered as part of the ceremony to dedicate the new cemetery there at Gettysburg 4 months after the battle. Lincoln delivered the entire speech, we're told, in about 2 minutes. Now, he was the last speaker on the program, and he was not the featured speaker. That honor fell to Edward Everett, the most renowned orator of the time. Everett's speech lasted 2 hours. Can you imagine a 2-hour speech? A speech little known, and it occurred to me what it would be like for you to hear that speech in its entirety. Every word. I thought it would be a unique experience for everyone here. So I've got it marked. Okay, I'm just kidding. But I will use the last sentence of his introduction of his 2-hour speech. And it was, "The duty to which you have called me must be performed.
Grant, I pray you your indulgence and your sympathy, and also express my hope for what is about to follow. When notified of being given tonight's award, Dr. Hall said in a letter she sent that there would be an opportunity for me to say a few words about the Heartland series. Frankly, I haven't slept well since. I want to call it the Edward Everett syndrome. How do you say everything you want to say and do it in less than 2 hours? I wanted these few words to be the perfect summarization of the joys, the struggles, the laughter, the complete weariness, the pride, the anger, and the happiness, the wonderful sense of team, alongside the absolute loneliness felt when staring at a blank page in want of words. All of those everyone at some time experienced while working on the Heartland series. There was, upon occasion, even the darkest of disappointment, but always the overarching belief was that the purpose was good. It was not just a career highlight, but a lifetime highlight for me. The only regret is not understanding that when in the middle of the work. All of us involved in the series felt it was more inspiring than the typical television job, but we were most often too busy pedaling the bike to take the time to look at the passing countryside or consider the distance we had come. But now we have reached that point in life to look back and consider what happened and why it became so important to the viewers. Before I talk about that, I would like to tell you how unlikely this evening would ever happen, and to recognize the people in attendance who worked on the Heartland series and made so many contributions. First of all, Jim Hart. Jim, would you just stand up, please? Just please. This is a fairly long story. So it was in 1983, Jim had an idea to do a 6-month series on the 50th anniversary of the founding of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. He wanted the series to present the stories of the mountain people who lived in the park area and to highlight the process of making the park. Again, it was to run for 6 months. In 1983, this was not a project that a media market television station had the means to do, at least not do well. Furthermore, Jim's plan to get it funded was totally unconventional with little chance of succeeding. Can you imagine carving out 5 minutes of your most valuable product, your newscast, and replacing that 5 minutes with a short program highlighting primarily the stories of old people and their history? These people would be way older than the desirable 18 to 49-year-olds the advertisers wanted. Truth be told, the station didn't have the equipment nor the staff to do it anyway. Nevertheless, when he asked me to head the project, I was more than happy to accept the challenge. My family was steeped in Southern Appalachia. My parents had lived for the first part of their lives in it and remained close to it. Jim also asked me to name the program, tell him how many people it would take to do 2 new episodes a week, hire the staff once it was sponsored, and provide the new staff with direction, guidance, and equipment. Jim said he would take care of the rest. My first hire was Bill Landry. Bill had little, if any, television experience, but he had a fascinating resume. College educated in theater, he had successfully traveled the country in a one-man show of his own making about Albert Einstein. He also had been a teacher at an East Tennessee high school, so I know he knew what real work meant. Bill was hired on a 3-month contract during which the two of us would work on 2 pilot episodes that could be shown to potential sponsors. One was a character study with Lucinda Ogle. As the subject, she was a member in high standing of the Great Smoky Mountains bloodline. She was the daughter of Wiley Oakley. Lucinda was delightful and most importantly, talkative. The second pilot episode was an historical reenactment of the travels through parts of the Smokies by William Bartram in 1775 and 1776. The pilot episodes were finished in about a month, and Jim took them on the road to get the Heartland series sponsored. The station's largest clients had little interest. Car dealers and fast food restaurants passed on sponsoring such a different program. How could this possibly help them sell cars or hamburgers? It was a valid question, and one that looked like it had no good answer. Jim called on all sorts of people. Banks turned us down. The soft drink industry didn't see how it fit their advertising goals. Finally, the clock ran out. No sponsor, no Heartland series. I will never forget the next 24 hours. I told Bill on a Friday, don't come back. Your contract's up. I'll get in touch with you if something happens. And I saw Jim in the hall sometime that day, and he said there was one more opportunity he would try to pursue. I think it was that evening, or it could have been on Saturday, I got a phone call. Phone rang. We didn't have a cell phone back then. It was Jim, and he had found a sponsor for the program. Martin Marietta was taking over the operation of all the Oak Ridge nuclear facilities and thought this program would be the perfect vehicle to help introduce them to the East Tennessee community. Since they had no plans to sell enriched uranium down at the Walmart, they didn't even want a commercial. Well, Jim was not going to have that. He insisted they do something. We weren't public television. Ultimately, they arranged for then-Governor Lamar Alexander to deliver a minute-long inspirational message about making the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. I had called Bill immediately after hanging up with Jim and told him he had six more months of work. And that is the short version of how the Heartland series began. In telling that, I want to say all the highlights of my career are due to Jim Hart. He provided me opportunities to do things that a person in a medium-sized television market would never get the chance to do. Not just with the Heartland series either. My main job, the one they really paid me for, was to be the creative director of the station. Jim provided me incredible opportunities in that capacity as well. Every creative person needs a Jim Hart. I am forever grateful for his appearance in my life. Thank you, Jim. And I would like everyone else to thank you. Oh, I'm glad I got that out. Okay. He's a wonder. The series had its last original content broadcast in 2016. A lot of people weren't aware, but we continued. After it was stopped, the station realized that a lot of people weren't happy with that, and so they hired me back on a contract basis to do hour-long shows. And we did 15 hours after the short ones ended. So it had lasted 32 years from that 6 months. And it kept going because the viewers wanted it to continue. Over those 32 years, many, many skilled people added their talents to the storytelling of the series. There were producers, editors, sound technicians, grips, and musicians, just to name a few. I invited all that I thought could think of that could make it here tonight. Of course, all of East Tennessee knows Bill Landry. He will always be the person, the name, and the face everyone associates with the program. It is a wonderful compliment to Bill's talent to engage and communicate with people, whether in person or through a script. He logged many miles in doing the show, and I can't tell you how many pairs of boots he tried to get me to buy him. And I'm not making that up either, folks. But such fame is also a curse. Try to have a relaxing meal in a restaurant with Bill anywhere in East Tennessee, and you'll understand why I say that. It is just impossible to do. Sean Kirk and Laura Armour were the first producers hired to start cranking out those two shows a week. It doesn't sound like much, but when the horse gets sick or they can't catch it, you got to make it up some way. Both have moved away but remain in touch. They really did groundbreaking work and helped develop the workflow we use throughout the series. Since about halfway through year one, there was in essence one videographer, Doug Mills, Douglas D. Mills, as he prefers. I cannot tell you what a physical accomplishment alone that is. In the early days, all the equipment was quite heavy, and he, along with the late Bill Archer, who we miss dearly, Bill Landry, and the producers, carried it over countless miles of mountain terrain, plowed fields, wadeable creeks and rivers, and forest trails. But all that mileage stands for nothing when compared to Doug's amazing imagery. Years from now, when the material is part of some digital visual archive preserved for research, the viewers will see the world through Doug's eye, and they will be richer for the experience. Please, when you get the chance, thank Doug. He might do the Doug dance for you too, which all the producers, that would mean you were doing good if Doug did the Doug dance. But when producers Sean and Laura left for other locales, they were replaced by Linda Billman. Okay. I have to gather myself here. Linda came to work at WBIR on the coldest day in Tennessee history. That doesn't have any deep meaning, but I thought it was interesting. Linda wrote and produced more of the short episodes than anyone. Not only did she write beautifully, her research was impeccable, and her producing skills simply the best. She was organized and conscientious. Linda has a blood pressure of 15 over 2. Unflappable, with great ability to operate in a crisis situation. Linda was as important as anyone in keeping the ship afloat. I think she cried only twice in my office, which is far fewer times than I did. Also here tonight is Amy Anderson. Amy came to the series from the news department. Other than me, she was the only person with news department experience to work on the series. She was also the youngest person as well. That's a tough situation. The youngest ever from the news department. And you're replacing the legendary Linda Billman. But let me tell you something right now. Amy Anderson is from Sevier County, and that doesn't mean a hill of beans. Amy Anderson knew or was related to half the people we had told stories about. She had grown up watching the Heartland series. Seriously, Amy was a wonderful addition. And my favorite April Fool's show of all time is totally her creation. And it was, if you've never seen the Elf Relocation Program, I urge you to check it out. It's hilarious and well done. There were many video editors on the show. I was, I guess, the first. But I'm going to just give you the people who've left the series, what they went on to do, aside from the people that you know here. After me, there was John Davis. He's going to school, he's a college kid. He now owns a music production company in New York City. Alexis Magnotti followed John. She's an attorney in Maryland, I think. My dear friend Joe Cable stepped in and subbed between Alexis's leaving and Amy Palmer becoming editor. Amy was supposed to come tonight, but I guess something happened. She's now a nurse, and as an editor, she had the same knack for calming producers' nerves. Then Ernie Engel, now a producer at Scripps Productions, and a producer's delight as well, laid back with wonderful ideas on how to make a show seem. The last and current editor, and actually still in charge of the Heartland series, is Sam Moore. Sam is very talented and the most precise video editor I ever worked with. It is not in his DNA to have anything be wrong. And if some flaw gets by him, he will sulk for days. I wish he were here to hear that. Most of the grips were college-age kids, strong legs to help pack the equipment to the views and vistas Doug's camera would capture. I have to mention the musicians that helped me find the unique musical themes. There was Kathy Leach, Evan Carillon, Tom Jester, and Michael Ginsberg. They created the themes that most people associate with this. Andrew Ramsey, who many of you probably don't know, he was still a music student at UT. He did much of the non-traditional music scores. Since then, he has toured with Amy Grant, won a few Grammys, and scored a number of motion pictures. We probably paid him minimum wage. I speak on the phone with Andrew every now and then, and he continues to think fondly of his experience. But enough about us. Let me put my marketing hat briefly on. When you go about the work of creating a brand or something that your company is famous for, it doesn't take you long to realize it can't be done. Not the best advertising in the world creates a brand. First, before anything else, there has to be a unique product that benefits customers, in our case, viewers. And viewers try the product and like it, then they start assigning in their mind what they think about it. Your viewers or customers or users, whatever they're called now, declare you have a brand. They own it. You do not. A brand lives in their mind, and advertising and marketing's role is to feed it. So many companies today get that wrong. Most often they bring a program or a product to market. When they want to, they do focus groups to see what their customers like or dislike about a proposed product. After the focus group, they go back to production and they take in the changes and that the focus group mentions and bring the product to market. The advertising mirrors back to the audience the words of the praise spoken in the focus groups. What they have left out and what the Heartland series did not leave out is they failed to make the product unique. When you only deliver something that the focus group wants, you deliver what is expected, not what is unique. The Heartland series was an enormous business risk with a high likelihood of failure. As is apparent, no other television station in Knoxville tried to copy it. The top 10 network shows, by the way, in 1984 include Dynasty, Dallas, The Cosby Show, The A-Team, Knots Landing, and Falcon Crest. Most of them soap operas about beautiful, wealthy people living in palatial estates whose only happiness seemed to be in getting wealthier at a family's member's expense. That was the television landscape when Heartland series first aired. Heartland was not about conspicuous consumption. There were no long driveways to magnificent mansions, although there were a number of long dirt roads. And quite frankly, there weren't many pretty people or money either. It was instead the stories and people that many East Tennesseans thought they didn't want to remember. The World's Fair in 1982 signified a great leap forward for East Tennessee. For at least 1 year, East Tennessee would be world famous for highlighting technology and the development of new energy resources, real cutting edge stuff. The 1982 World's Fair remains an impressive accomplishment. Now, in 1982, Knoxville was still referred to as a scruffy little city by the national press, but most who live here felt the rough-hewn East Tennessee heritage no longer represented who they were. That had been set aside as part of the past. For some, the traditions of the past were simply not a comfortable fit with the new direction and energy of Southern Appalachia. 2 years after the World Fair closed, the Heartland series began. It featured people that frankly weren't representative of the modern environment. Most viewers certainly didn't expect to see or hear them on television. Their dress, their mountain accents, and rural sensibility was a TV consultant's nightmare, but their easy smiles and comfortable manner were endearing. The fact that a television camera was pointed at them seemed not to make any difference to them. They spoke plainly about what they knew or felt. Ethel Birchville perhaps put it best. It was easy as spitting off the porch. One of our hard-charging national sales managers vehemently complained after he was not able to sell sponsorships to large metropolitan ad agencies. We had provided him with excerpts from the shows, And so he would take them out and show them this is what it's about. And one included Ethel talking about spitting off the porch. He stormed into the meeting. Never forget, Bill's in there. He angrily said, after his trip, he said, "Ethel killed us in Chicago." I mean, he was mad, red faced and everything. But she was magic in East Tennessee, pure magic. Our people, the folks who peopled our stories, were representatives of a closing generation that had lived in remarkable times. Most had ridden horseback in their youth with no other option available. In fact, most of them were born depending totally on animals for life. Can you imagine? For transportation, for food, for clothing, for selling for a little bit of cash money. They were the last generation to fully flourish in a primitive rural lifestyle, and in turn had watched men land on the moon. The end result was surprising. Well, I skipped a page there. Many had left the farm for industrial jobs, Danny. Some made do working the small plot of the family farm they had inherited. They appeared totally comfortable with who they were and their station in life, a station many others had abandoned in the rush to modernity. For native East Tennesseans, the show proved there was no need to ignore or be embarrassed by the region's past. It was a past no less noble or no less flawed than anywhere else. The struggle of blacks in Appalachia mirrors the African-American struggles throughout the country and cannot be denied. Yet visit the rural African-American communities of Hoop Creek in Claiborne County, and the black families working family farm plots in Monroe County, and you will see a value system and culture consistent with the surrounding area. For whites and blacks in Appalachia, where you are, really seem to determine who you are and what you believe. Southern Appalachian history fits alongside the story of America and builds the bigger picture of our country. For newcomers to East Tennessee, the series was a way to see flesh and blood people emerge from behind the stereotypes of Southern Appalachia. They were people of accomplishment, wit, and reverence. The less than perfect were part of the story as well. They existed side by side with the inspirational, and the Heartland series tried to explain how both sides fit together. Frankly, authors and historians had written about Appalachian culture for decades. The difference was that in 1984, a popular and contemporary media, television, was sharing the images and stories. The episodes were being presented with vivid storytelling and as visually rich as we could make them. Magically then, it was as if this new exposure gave new relevance to the past. I would compare it today to say, when a new tribe is discovered living along the Amazon, the reaction you get, really, those people exist? Can you imagine? Ironically, television, one of the creations of the modern consumer society, had paused to consider the past, and when it did, it gave vitality to the buried soul of a region. So what's next? The generation that graced the Heartland series and recentered the region's understanding of the past has now passed on. What is there left to talk about? Who is left to talk to? Well, take a trip to the local bookstore and you'll see that once again, being poor, Southern, and yes, from Appalachia, is once again at the center of national attention. J.D. Vance's Hillbilly Elegy. Gotta read it, people. Don't watch TV, read it. Is a personal memoir of a young man's journey out of an Appalachian coal town to Yale Law School and beyond. Vance put forward the theory that the hard-fighting, hard-drinking nature of Scots-Irish has made much of poorest Appalachia what it is today. One thing is certain, his mamaw would never have appeared on the Heartland series. For those of you who read the book, you know what I'm talking about. Her language would make a longshoreman blush. She just might make Ethel Birchfield blush. But Mamaw's fight to help Vance to grow out of poverty is impressive. The conservative right has embraced the 34-year-old's conclusion that the social welfare system has done nothing to help the situation in Appalachia. And conversely, the liberal left has demonized Vance as short-sighted and flawed in his view of the problems and solutions necessary for Appalachia. You'll love this one. White Trash, written by Dr. Nancy Eisenberg. Has anyone read this yet? Well, you ought to. Did Henry say he hadn't read this yet? Henry can't read, by the way. According to Dr. Eisenberg, she attempts to establish that poor white people, or white trash, were sent here by the English in order to cleanse the mother country of the unwanted vermin, and in turn were kept in a perpetual state of poverty by the classism of the founding fathers. She contends these landless poor were sent west, meaning south, or to Appalachia, in various schemes designed to keep them away from proper society and to continue to be landless. Eisenberg doesn't believe the Scots-Irish exist, that they were created by a flawed historical study that simply relabeled white trash as Celtic ethnics. She even throws Benjamin Franklin under the bus for building a hospital for poor working people, but not a hospital for all poor people. Dr. Eisenberg's historical research is impressive, but to her, NASCAR, the Dukes of Hazzard, Dolly Parton, and Tammy Faye Baker are all close to the same thing. And according to one of the glowing reviews of her book, they are symbolic of the country's rotting underpinnings brought on by classism. I have not finished the book, but I'm pretty sure fried chicken will not go unscathed in this book. What both books point out is a serious problem in today's Appalachia. Hillbilly Elegy exposes the rampant substance abuse and rising suicide rates in the mountain communities. The main streets of once active towns are now a collection of empty storefronts. Pain clinics, payday loan operations, and pawn shops alone seem to find a way to hang on. Much of Appalachia has the look of a place about to give up. In my opinion, Eisenberg's book, White Trash, is indicative of the distaste and outright revulsion with which the South, and certainly Appalachia, is viewed by a modern and increasingly urban America. In either case, this was not the Appalachia described or explored by the Heartland series. We found and celebrate an ascendant population, people who overcame poverty so harsh as to be beyond the understanding of anyone born within the last 50 years. They fought off the scourges of hookworm, pellagra, and all manner of disease brought on by filthy living conditions. They found whatever work they could and flourished through it. With government-created jobs, some built national parks and great dams. Our interview subjects certainly knew there were wealthier people in the world, but they never considered themselves to be a lower class. The only true poverty in my mind is the loss of self-esteem and self-worth, and they exhibited none of that. The Heartland series started a conversation that should not end. It may have been initially about building a national park, but it became a recognition of the goals, aspirations, and accomplishment of a generation of people. People who believed in themselves and believed in each other. That understanding alone should continue. Currently, I serve on the board of the Museum of Appalachia. The president of the museum, Elaine Meyer, and her husband, Ed, are here. And I know they would welcome any college student with an interest in Appalachian culture to engage with the museum's holdings. The massive collection would also benefit from the student's study and curation. I feel confident there are an untold number of scholarly articles and perhaps a thesis or two contained at that museum. I met Stephen Scruggs. Stephen, raise your hand, please. He's my fly fishing buddy, too. He owns a fly rod built by Walter Babb, by the way. I met him when I took on the task of transcribing the records of the 1st U.S. Colored Heavy Artillery. That's a regiment of African Americans that formed in Knoxville in 1864. Stephen leads a program to try to convince young elementary students to teach their community about the people buried at Oddfellows Cemetery, which contains the bodies of many of these 1st U.S. Colored Heavy Artillery. Stephen was born in Knoxville, attended West Point, and had never heard of the colored troops here. That transcription project has roughly transcribed about 2,000 of the 3,000 pages of rosters, orders, and letters generated by the regiment. But proofing needs to be done. Any Carson-Newman history student or class that wants to see how an African-American regiment interacted with an overwhelmingly white Appalachian community in the middle of the 19th century is welcome to participate, either in proofing the final transcriptions or transcribing them initially. Whether or not the conversation that the Heartland series started continues as a television program is probably not as important as it was in 1984. The media landscape provides so many different opportunities today. The new digital spectrum offers a means to present the trials of the Appalachian people to a broader world. It would take a truly committed staff to publish to the web only, for the rewards, at least initially, would not be monetary. While all that gets sorted out, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of hours of unedited, unseen video interviews and travels dating from 1984 until 2016, residing on shelves both at WBIR and the McClung Collection of the Knox County Library. Hopefully, easy access will be made available to the general public sometime in the future. I want to close with some words from a man descended from the white trash of Appalachia. In 1935, young James Agee wrote an article about the newly formed TVA, and in that article he tried to describe who the Appalachian people were to the urbane metropolitan readers of Fortune magazine. He writes, "He is a mountaineer. His forefathers settled this country in the 1700s when the effete civilization of the Alleghenies struck in their craws. They whipped the Britisher and Loyalists at King's Mountain. They kept much to themselves, and their great-grandsons do the same and live in much the same way. While slowly the sawmills and the mines and the railways and the highways and now TVA burn seclusion from around them. Such are the raw materials, good and ill, from which TVA prepares to fashion a civilization, which, in a certain important way, is new and significant to all of us in the U.S. Surely we will always have an interest in these people, and we will not let others characterize them in terms less or more than what they truly are. I want to thank the staff and administration of Carson-Newman for presenting this award, and to thank all the people in the room here who made the award and the Heartland series possible. And on the very top of that list is my family, my wife Nancy, daughter Whitney, son Travis, my grandsons, and our son Adam watching from heaven. When you are as immersed in a career as I was in mine, some things suffer. Nancy was the rock that kept the family together, growing and centered. I missed way too many opportunities to be with the children. They always acted like they understood. My family is my richest blessing. Straight from my heart to all of you, thank you. Wait a minute. Can I mention my sisters? I want to mention, they, what? I already have? Okay. I'm not at 2 hours. I've got 4 minutes. They surprised me by coming here tonight, which they drove from Arkansas and Georgia, and I just want to thank them so much for doing that. And I want to just tell you just a little bit about them. And I didn't write it down. Teddy is the middle child. She was a librarian, a teacher, a school administrator for many, many years. And Teddy had a really unique experience as a child. God came to Teddy and spoke to her and said, Teddy, in a few months you're going to have a younger brother. And because he's a boy child, and your mother has always wanted a boy child, and because your older sister will adore him, he will think he is the center of the earth. And God said, Teddy, it's going to be your job to convince him that is not the case. And that convincing may take him near the end of his life on a couple of times. Teddy, can you do this? God said. Teddy said, yes, I can. And it came to pass. She did, but I survived. My sister Sandra, also a teacher. Jim, who just put his hand on her head, is the bravest man I know. He rototills a garden in his bare feet. And if you don't think that takes guts, you have never tried it. But those two people, after they retired, I want to tell you what they did. They decided to go to Bangladesh and run a hostel for Baptist missionaries, which they did for a year or year and a half, something like that. Well, there's other part to that story. And while they were over there, the tidal wave hit, what's it?
Tsunami.
What?
Tsunami.
The tsunami hit Sri Lanka. I was going to say Shangri-La, but it was Sri Lanka. And they went over there and helped those. So they're incredible people. They're children of Appalachia. They grew up in a farm with a four-room shack for the first 6 or 7 years of their life. They know what Appalachia. I was a suburban kid, but I love the country. And I just want you to recognize them. And my cousin Joe's there too. He also went to the country. Joe Piper, raise your hand, Joe. I see him at Henry. Anyway, that's all I got. Thank you very much. This has been so much to me. I can't express it anymore, and I'm just so grateful for having done this. Thank you so much.